copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars. Attention all cars. Broadcast 210 regarding an escaped prisoner. Suspected crime is a male American, 5 feet 11 inches. Weight about 170 pounds. This man escaped from an officer while en route to Los Angeles. He's thought to be hiding in the Tehachapi Mountains. This man is dangerous. That's all. Rosenberg.
I know you will all agree that a shop foreman who does not give his men the right kind of tools to work with has no right to complain if they turn out faulty, imperfect work. Likewise, you are the boss of your car, and if you provide it with an inferior or average gasoline, you have no one to blame for an inefficient motor but yourself. But power it with Rio Grande cracked gasoline, and you have every right to expect, and you will get, the same faster getaway. Steadier, purring acceleration, longer mileage, greater reserve power, and maximum speed, which the drivers of police cars and other emergency equipment get by always filling up with Rio Grande cracked gasoline. Because they demand all of these essential qualities, the officials of 30 leading cities and counties specify Rio Grande cracked as the gasoline used exclusively to power their emergency public service cars. Be a good boss. Give your car the best gasoline there is to work with. Drop in at the red and white station of your friendly Rio Grande dealer tomorrow morning and give your car the means of delivering police car performance by taking aboard a tank full of Rio Grande crack, the most highly recommended gasoline in the West. Tonight, we again take pleasure in presenting Chief James E. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department. Chief Davis.
Good evening, friends. There seems to be a general, though erroneous idea, that so-called society crooks are of a higher type of criminal. This is not true. It is, of course, the foregone conclusion that any person is going to fail at any game outside the law. He may get by for months or even years, but eventually he is going to wind up behind bars. That is certain. But there are not many criminals who will admit this. Fully 50% of the society crook's intake goes for transportation and hotel bills. He must keep on the move continuously. Then there are the usual rounds of the nightclubs and parties, where the crook must pose as a big shot. Show me a man who has spent a lifetime outside the law, and I'll show you a man who will die a pauper. I am not moralizing in making this statement. It is a fact. The story which you will hear tonight definitely shows that crime does not pay.
In a hotel in downtown Los Angeles, a man and a woman are dancing.
Yeah, you're a pretty good dancer. Where'd you learn?
Oh, I've been around. You're not so bad yourself.
Thanks. You live here in a hotel?
Mm-hmm.
You been here long?
Oh, about a week.
Know many people?
Not many.
Where are you from?
Denver.
You married?
At present.
What do you mean, at present?
Well, I'm thinking of not going back.
I see. Would you like a drink?
Oh, I don't mind.
Should we go up to my room?
Well,
I see. Old-fashioned girl.
No, I'm not.
Okay, forget it.
I'll prove I'm not old-fashioned. Let's go up to my room.
Well, that's absurd. Let's go.
I always have trouble getting this key in.
Let me try it. There you are.
Oh, thanks. Now for our little drink.
Right here. I always have a full flask with me.
Oh, I'll call for some ice and seltzer water.
Okay. Hey, is this a picture of your husband?
Over there? Oh, yes. Room service, please. Can you send up some ice and seltzer to 309?
Hey, he's not a bad-looking hombre.
He's got a disposition like a bear.
I don't see how he could have, but you're around.
Maybe. But I'm not around.
That's my good luck.
Think so?
Sure I do. Come here.
Hey, wait a minute. You're a fast worker, aren't you?
Why waste valuable time?
Take it easy, big boy. Well, I don't even know your name yet.
Is that necessary?
Well, I might get tired of saying, hey, you.
You won't have to call me. I won't be far.
Sure of yourself, aren't you?
I have to be.
Oh, yes?
Room service.
Just a minute.
No. You want something?
You surely can muck a person up. Well, that will be all. Thanks. Well, I said that will be all.
Yes, ma'am.
Hey, what's the matter with that boy?
How should I know? Come on, let's drink. Say when.
When?
The shelter? Well, here you are. Here's to it.
To us.
Come on, sit down. Here.
Oh, that's so tight.
Can't take it, huh?
We'll see.
It's a nice ring you're wearing.
Oh, engagement.
Good-looking watch.
Yeah, anniversary.
Must have set the old man back a pretty penny.
Oh, he can stand it. He's got plenty.
You love him?
A little.
Love me?
Maybe. Let's have another drink.
Okay. Enough?
Okay.
Well, here's to you.
To you.
Now we're getting somewhere. Sleepy?
Liquor always does that to me.
You know what to do about that, don't you?
Sure. Good night.
Good night?
Yes. Good night.
Oh, good night.
Nights later, in another hotel in the downtown district.
Oh, I beg your pardon. I didn't see you standing there.
Oh, that's all right. I should have been watching more carefully.
Do you always watch carefully?
Well, I don't believe I understand you.
Well, that's my misfortune. Do you mind if I join you in your walk? You see, I'm a stranger here, and well, you know how it is.
Yes, I do. However, I'm not taking a walk. I was just going to have a cocktail before I went to my room.
Well, so was I. Will you allow me?
I shouldn't, but I will.
Thank you. I think the hotel has a bar.
Oh, don't you stop here?
Yes, I just registered. I have a room on the 8th floor.
How odd. My room's on the 8th, too.
Well, we'll have to get better acquainted.
Yes, we will.
Here we are.
Yes, sir. What's for you?
What'll it be?
Old-fashioned.
Make my mistake.
Yes, sir.
That's a beautiful ring you have on. Engagement?
Yes.
Recently?
Uh-huh.
You sound rather happy about it.
I am.
That's well. I haven't been so lucky along that line.
Here you are. Thank you, sir. That's right.
Well, cheer up. You're young yet.
Maybe I can make something out of that. Golf.
Can do.
Well, should we go up now?
Yep. Think we shall.
You know, I've been losing too much sleep lately.
You better watch yourself. You'll be losing that boy's figure.
Yeah. Probably get circles under my eyes.
Up. 8, please. 8.
Nice weather we're having.
Now, that has all the earmarks of a bored young woman's way of closing a conversation.
Nothing of the sort. I do think the weather's nice.
Maybe it is at that. I haven't noticed.
Have you lived here long?
Well, no. As a matter of fact, I just came to town.
Oh, then I'll probably see you around occasionally.
Very probably, if you let me be seen.
I'll consider it.
Eight, please.
My room's right around the corner. Well, good night.
Oh, I'll see you safely tucked in.
Tucked in?
Well, at least inside the door.
That's better.
Get inside.
What's the meaning of this?
Pipe down. Give me that sparkler.
Well, I'll do nothing of the sort.
Oh, yes, you will. Get over there, you little tramp. Now, give me that ring.
You keep away from me.
Now, just take this watch first. Now, that ring. Shut up, you little fool. You want everybody in the joint up here?
Yes. Help, help, help.
You asked for it, sister. Hey, let go there. Oh, you're trying to tear Michael.
Hours later, the bruised and battered girl recovered consciousness. Sobbing with hysteria, she dragged her way to the telephone, summoned the hotel manager. That horrified official called the police, and Detective J.E. Morris of the robbery squad, working alone, responded to the call.
No, Miss Martin. Now try to calm yourself and tell me what happened.
Well, I met this man downstairs.
Yeah?
I was coming around the corner in the lobby, and he bumped into me. I didn't think anything of it at the time.
Probably deliberate.
Then we went in and had a drink in the bar, and he said he lived on this floor.
Had you mentioned your floor before he said that?
No, I don't think I did.
Then what did you drink?
Well, we came up in the elevator together, and he said something about tucking me in.
Make any other propositions?
No, I resented his attitude, though. He seemed defensive. Then I unlocked the door. When I did, he opened the door and shoved me into the room. I said something to him, and he struck me. Then he asked me for my ring.
Did you give it to him?
No, but he caught hold of my wrist and jerked my watch off. Then he pulled the ring off. I screamed for help, and he started beating me.
Tore your finger up quite a bit, didn't you?
Yes.
You'd better get to a doctor and have that fixed up. Now then, Miss Martin, can you give me a description of this man?
Oh, yes, sir. Oh, I just thought of something.
Yeah, what's that?
Well, when he hit me the first time, I sort of fell to one side, and I grabbed his coat pocket, the breast pocket. It had a card in it, and when I tore the pocket, I held on to the card. He grabbed part of it away from me, but here's the other piece.
May I see that a moment? F-E-R. Evident as the last part of a name. Have any idea what this man's name was?
No, I never saw him before.
F-E-R. That might be anything from a firm name to an ash can. F-E-R.
I want my ring back. I don't care about anything else. I just want the ring back.
Back at headquarters, Morris begins the interminable task of trying to find a man whose surname ends with the letters F-E-R. Hour after weary hour, he pores over record cards of arrests in similar cases, always hoping against hope that he'll find a name ending in F-E-R.
Banker, Battler, Bauer, Baxter. Falcon, Fagan, Farset, Faversham, Fawcett. Lincoln, Long Green, Long Necker, Lugger. Stanley, Anderson, Fagan, Shaddock, Schaefer. Schaefer. F-E-R. S-H-A-F. F-E-R. Schaefer. That's it. Schaefer. Charles B., 5'11", weight 170, blonde hair, blue eyes, suspicion of robbery. 1926-1927. That's my man. Same method of operation, same description. Okay, Mr. Schaefer. I'll be seeing you.
The address given on the record card of the suspect, Charles Schaefer, Speed Detective Morris.
Yeah, want to see somebody, mister?
I'm Officer Morris, police robbery detail. I'm looking for a chap named Schaefer. He lives here, I believe.
Nope, you're wrong. He used to live here.
What do you mean he used to?
Well, he moved out this morning.
Know where he moved to?
Nope, none of my business.
Mind if I look over his room?
Nope, won't do no good, though. Cleaned it up this morning after he left. This way my wife did.
I'd like to look it over if you don't mind.
All right, come along. Right in here.
Okay. Why the hurry to clean the place up?
Well, I want to rent it again. Won't find nothing in there. Clean it out.
So I see. Anything in the closet?
Nope. You might as well look, though.
No luck here.
What are you looking at this telephone for?
There's numbers written on the wall.
Ain't none there. I rubbed them out with an eraser.
You're a thorough guy, aren't you?
It's like to have the place ready for a new rumor.
You know anything about this fellow Scherzer?
Nope. Never paid no attention to him. He just come in, went out when he got ready.
You know anybody he ran around with?
Nope.
He kept his rent paid up, huh?
Yep.
Seemed to have plenty of money.
All he needed.
You know anything about his girlfriend?
Nope. Never did see none.
Well, you know anything about any phone calls he got or any he made?
Well, some gal called him up once or twice. Don't know nothing about her, though.
Mm-hmm. You mind if I just stick around in here a while and see what I can find?
Nope. That's sure.
Although Morris went over every inch of closet and places about the room where a clue might be hidden, the officer found nothing. Still in his mind, there lingered the thought that somewhere in that room was a clue, something important that he had overlooked. Day after day, he returned to the house, but each time his search of the room was fruitless. Then, one day, almost a week after his first search, he made a final trip to the room.
I'm sorry to trouble you again, but I'd like to lift that room over again.
All right. I didn't think you're crazy, though.
Maybe, sir. I got a hunch I've overlooked something in that room.
All right. Come on in. Look at it till you're blind if you want to.
You know, what I like about you is your spirit of cooperation.
Yep, I thought so. Well, why don't you start looking?
Oh, don't worry about me. Just go on about your work. I'll just sit here for a few minutes.
Hey, here's a bed bug. Sit down completely.
This thing doesn't make sense. There's bound to be something up in this. No bird ever pulled a set of deals like this without leaving some sound. Wonder what I've missed. And there's bound to be a woman in there somewhere, too. Yeah, what's that, a piece of paper sticking out of the baseboard? Just a piece of paper. I'll take a look at this one. Oh, a piece of envelope, huh? Oh, some numbers. 6945. 6945. I've got it. That's a telephone number. I've got Mr. Schaefer right where I want him.
Back to headquarters rushed Detective Morris, his brain afire with plans for the capture. Hurriedly he began calling the number 6945, using every possible Los Angeles exchange.
6945.
Hello?
Mr. Schaefer, then? Never mind. Oh, hello, Charlie Schaefer there. Okay.
Yeah?
Oh, hello, I want Charlie Schaefer.
Thus, weary hour after hour, modest dials, telephone numbers, all to no avail. Schaefer is not known in Los Angeles. Then, in desperation, Morris takes the number and goes to the office of Special Investigator Claude Peterson of the telephone company.
Hey, Claude, I've got a number. I know it's a phone number. I've tried every exchange in Los Angeles. Now I want to check your long-distance calls and see if we can find out where that number is.
You haven't, by any chance, lost your mind, have you?
I don't know. I'm beginning to wonder. And just the same, I want to check those calls.
How far back do you want to go?
6 months, if necessary.
Okay. Let's get out of the file room and get at it.
Look, boss, I'm willing to go through a lot for the police department, but this is too much.
Oh, come on now. Let's look at just a few more cards.
Look as long as you want to. I'm quitting.
Hey, wait a minute.
What now?
Take a look at that.
Well, I'm a dirty name. 6945, Medford, Oregon. 2270 Oregon Place. Well, can you tie that?
I think I can. Right to the coattail of Charlie Schaefer.
Chief of Police, Medford, Oregon. Please go to 2270 Oregon Place and arrest and hold Charles B. Schaefer. This man's wanted for robbery by the Los Angeles police. Notify Morris. Robbery is there. 45 minutes later.
Morris. Robbery. LAPD. Have Charles Schaefer in custody. Found him at the address given by you. Advise disposition.
North to Medford, said Officer Morris, armed with writ of extradition for Charles B. Schaefer. In Medford, however, he meets with delay. Then one day at the railway station in Medford.
I tell you, Morris, you're foolish to try to make this trip as ill as you are.
Well, I've been here 3 weeks, son. I've got to get this bird back for trial.
But what if something happens to you? You won't be able to defend yourself or do anything if you decided to get tough.
I'll keep an eye on him.
Yes, but you've already spent 2 days in the hospital. You're not well enough to be up now.
Oh, it's okay. The doctor gave me a prescription to take, didn't he? I'll be all right.
Okay, have it your own way.
That's it. I'll be seeing you sometime.
So long, Morris. Let me know if you need any help.
Through the Oregon countryside, sped the train bearing Morris and his prisoners, mile after mile, flying like fugitive shadows past the compartment windows. Then, back in Medford, a frantic telephone shouts an alarm in the home of Chief of Police.
Yes?
The chief, I
don't
know what else to do.
What's all the excitement?
You know that Los Angeles officer?
Morris?
Yes, but I took a prescription for him early this morning.
Good Lord, man, do you realize what this might mean?
Well,
stay where you are. I'll be right down.
Back on the train, Officer Morris, having taken the tablets according to the doctor's instructions, lies sleeping in his berth. Above, handcuffed and manacled at the sleeping officer below, a restless prisoner tossed in his bed. Stealthily, silently, he removes from a small truck a pair of flat-nosed pliers. Carefully, he places them in the double side of the peerless handcuffs and slips hard against the case-hardened steel. Bit by bit, grinding his teeth with pain as the metal cuts into his flesh, Schaefer pries at the cuff. Little by little, he loosens the rivet that holds him prison. At last, his hands are free. Cautiously, he tries to tackle about his ankle. It is loose. Tearing at the flesh of the ankle, the chain is forced down and off. Then, as the pale fingers of dawn push back the curtain of snow blanketed night, the train labors up to the hatch to grade. Dropping silently through the corridor, Schaefer makes his way to the vestibule, opens the trap door leading to the steps, and lets himself off into the snow. The summit reached, the train begins its downward flight as the fugitive takes stock of his surroundings. Our scene shifts now to the office of the sheriff of Kern County. Highway Patrolman William Snare reports for duty.
Hi, Reynolds. Anything going?
No, not much. Prisoner got away from the Los Angeles officers, going up at the Hatchet Grade. Hey, the boys over at Mojave found one of our stolen cars. That's about all.
Well, let's take a run over to Mojave and pick up the car. Got a description of the prisoner?
Yep, right here.
His record looks like a tough customer, doesn't it?
They're all alike to me.
Yeah, getting me scared now. I'd shoot any of them.
Well, better get started. Looks like he's liable to snow or anything.
Keep your eyes peeled for any stray cars. We've had a lot of them stolen lately.
Yeah, regular epidemic. That is a Chevy. Head up the road there, please.
Yeah, get the license number. We'll check on it on the way back.
Okay. That's probably the one we're looking for.
Hey, Joe.
Hmm?
Take a look at that fellow up the road there.
Yeah. You better ask him a few questions.
Come over here a minute, fella.
Yeah?
What are you doing out here at this time of the morning?
Well, I'm a milkman. I held up a little while ago. The guy took my car and beat it.
Oh, yeah? Well, get in. We'll see if we can find him on our way over to Mojave.
You can get in the middle.
Okay. Where are you from?
I work out of Clerkrig.
Clerkrig, huh?
Yeah.
Well, we'll get a report on your holdup when we get over to the Hatchet. Joe, come here. Come here, will you?
Yeah, what is it?
Say, bring that bird into the telephone office here. I don't like his look. Yeah. Let's keep our eyes on him.
Yeah. Hey, you come on in. Hey?
Yeah. Okay.
Good morning, Captain Sarah. What brings you to Tehachapi so early?
Well, yeah, looking for stolen cars and suspects. Get me a ranking in the sheriff's office in Bakersfield, will you?
Right away, Captain.
You got the license number of that stolen car, Joe?
Yeah, right here.
I'll check on that. So how about the escaped prisoner's description?
I left it in my book. It's in the car. I'll get it.
Never mind.
Huh?
Stay here.
Yeah.
I'll get it from Rankin.
Here's your car, Captain. Take it in the first booth there.
Okay. Hello, Rankin. So give me a description of that prisoner that got away from Morris. Yeah? Yeah? 5'11". Yeah. Well, I think we've got him.
Hey, what are you trying to do? What do you think you're taking me back for?
Say, don't get tough, young fella. We're taking you back whether you like it or not.
Oh, you think so, do you? Hey,
yeah,
you give me that gun.
We've got this guy up on the road, and we're walking around on the way over to my hobby.
Billy's got my gun.
Put that gun down.
That's the you, copper.
You got him, Bill. Hello, Rankin. Say, never mind the description. Notify Morris that we got his man. And send out the coroner.
A motorist's best friend or worst enemy is his gasoline. Some brands are what you might call fair weather friends, but Rio Grande Tracks is the kind of friend that never lets you down, no matter how hard the going or how severe the demands of unforeseen emergencies. Regardless of weather conditions, Rio Grande Cracks gives your motor the maximum performance of which it is capable. The drivers of your emergency public-serving cars discovered that fact by testing all brands of motor fuel. Then they rolled up 55 million miles of the hardest, fastest kind of driving over California highways using Rio Grande Cracks exclusively. If you want that kind of a friend, giving your motor more efficient operation and saving you money in the bargain, let the man with the red and white Rio Grande station introduce. Drive in tomorrow morning. Fill up with Rio Grande cracked gasoline. Don't envy the police car performance of your neighbor's car. Get police car efficiency in your own with Rio Grande cracked. The favorite gasoline of those who drive the most and those who think the most of their car. And now again, we hear, keep safe.
The desperation of the man Schaffer and his determination to escape punishment for his crime caused him to pay the supreme penalty for his deed. No stigma attached to either Detective Morris, who lost the fugitive, or to Officer Reynolds, whose gun Schaffer snatched in his effort to gain freedom. In Morris' case, the suddenness of the attack rendered him helpless to defend himself. At all events, Schaffer's crime failed to pay.
Thank you, Chief Davis.
Attention all cars. The cancellation of broadcast 210 regarding an escaped prisoner. This man shot by highway patrolman Snare while resisting arrest. That's all. Hold and wait.
Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for Rio Grande. Copyrighted program created by Rio Grande. Chandler and Unit Sheriff's Office.